morning, good morning, good morning, and welcome. Welcome to the Restoration.
Yeah. Mercy and grace, oh, take me. Hallelujah. Salvation is available. Freedom.
need a word, if you need your ears unplugged, and you need to hear from the voice of God, I give you the pressure to move up the further, because I believe in what does take all of that. It does take all of that. So I know we're over time right now. And if you just press us a little bit further, I believe no breakthrough is happening.
Filled with direct paths and easy solutions. that things do not always go just how we thought they would. Dreams can come true, but they are not always the path that we imagined. The Lord can bring you out of some difficult places, but how many have found out it may not always be as smooth as you hoped it would be? You may even have the perfect plan, but you still don't know what tomorrow is going to bring. Proverbs 27:1 says, "Boast not thyself of tomorrow, for thou knowest not what a day may bring forth." In Deuteronomy 8:2, Moses talks about remembering the way which the Lord led Israel out of Egypt. God delivered Israel out of Egypt, but he did not take them on a direct path unto the promised land called Canaan. I want to encourage you today that God is faithful. You need to know, you need to be encouraged, you need to be assured of the fact that God is faithful and able to deliver you. And he's able to get us through any difficult situation that we might face. But I have to warn you that it may not happen the way that we thought it would happen. That there are times that we have to wait, even when we don't want to. Sometimes we just have to wait. Amen. Waiting sometimes is not even a choice. But you don't have to have faith to wait sometimes. You don't have to pray about it to wait. But if God decides he's not going to move yet, you just have to wait. But Isaiah 40:31 says, "But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not get weary. They shall walk and not faint." Made me think of the song, "I Don't Mind Waiting," because God will bring us through. Let us talk about this for a little while. When you look here in this 14th chapter of the book of Exodus, the children of Israel have been led by God to a place where Pharaoh seems to think they are entangled. After over 400 years enslaved in the land of Egypt, God leads them out with a great deliverance, using 10 plagues to dismantle every idol worshiping God, every idol worship God, and to show Pharaoh that the God of Israel was greater than the God of Egypt. He showed them that, and he delivered them and brought them out. According to biblical history and geographical facts, the belief of Pharaoh's and how he did this is justified, that they were tangled up in the wilderness. There's no doubt about it. They were in a tangled up place. Verse 2 speaks. It speaks to God telling Moses that I want you to do something that even leads to this entanglement. It's in verse 2 that God tells Moses, I want you to change directions. Exodus 14:2 speaking to the children of Israel that they turn and encamp. Amen. He wants them to turn and make a camp in a completely different direction than where they were headed. Now, we've always complained about Israel murmuring and complaining. We've always talked about how ungrateful they were and how they acted. But if you would just allow yourself to be humble enough to be placed into this situation and look at this story in a little bit more detail, Israel's told, amen, that God is about to deliver them. God uses 10 miraculous plagues and gets them out of the land of Egypt. Israel is heading on a direct route, amen, to Canaan. God has given them a path, amen. They get close to the borders of the desert. Right about when they seem to be going in the right direction, right about when they seem to be, and this is a geographical and theological fact in my studies, that they were almost at the place where Pharaoh and his army would no longer be able to pursue them. Right when they get about at this place, God does something that allows the enemy to have hope. He makes them make a turn away from where they were going. Now, it's not just that they turn, but God had them turn from going to the promised land and had them turn and go a direct opposite way. Pharaoh had to think what was going on. I let them go so that they could go worship. And now I get word that they are heading in the wrong direction. Not only are they heading in the wrong direction, but they're heading to a place where they can't get out of. If you were one of the 2 million or so folk that got out, I would like to bring your attention to the 1,999,999. They did not get the word like Moses got to turn. Only thing they knew was that they had to turn. They did not understand, nor could they get a grip on the fact that they were almost close to the place that they had to go. Almost at the place where Egypt could no longer pursue them. All of a sudden, those in the back in the middle of the line look and see that the line that Moses is leading is no longer heading towards the promised land. But they made a detour, and nobody understands why. Not only have they made a detour, but they made a stop, and they made an encampment in the midst of the detour that places them still in the reach of Pharaoh and Egypt. Instead of pursuing their journey eastward with the sea on the right, they were suddenly commanded to diverge to the south, keeping the Gulf on their left, a route which could only be detained by them lingering in the confines and staying close to Egypt. But in adopting this path and taking on this decision, now Egypt has turned their backs on the land which they set out to walk into. They've turned their backs on the land that has been promised to them. Now they find themselves tangled up in the wilderness. When Pharaoh finds out about this situation, Pharaoh looks and sees that they find themselves in a bad place. No longer are they on the journey to the place called Canaan, but God has them go a completely different route, a route that leaves them trapped with mountains and rocks on the sides, with the sea in the front, and the enemy coming from behind. If you were one of the 1,999,999, it would seem to mess you up that you get to the place where you know you can't go nowhere else. You can't go to your left and you can't go to your right. It's literally impossible for you to go straight ahead. But in your rear, you hear the sound of your enemy coming down across your back. What do you do when you feel trapped and you can't run and you can't hide? What do you do when you feel trapped? You don't see a way out and there's nothing nobody can do. What do you do when you feel trapped and you feel like the trap that you're in was because you made a mistake? What do you do when you're trapped? When you realize you were just so close to being free, but now find yourself with death chasing you from the rear end? What do you do? Israel found themselves in a place where God took them and had them sit there and wait. You've been journeying, you've been traveling, but now God tells you to sit there and wait. You've been going on your journey trying to get to your promised land, excited about your deliverance. But God has you sit there and wait. God tells them to sit there and wait. Now this place that they are waiting is a place that is believed that the mariners, those the fishermen, they worship another idol god. You see, if you look at the story, God was not through yet. In the midst of the 10 plagues, he had shown them that the gods that Israel, that Egypt was serving, were not a match for Israel. But now here, God takes them to the place where those who are fishermen began to worship a god that stood like a serpent deity. He was supposed to be the guardian of the seas. Israel, God is taking Israel down to the place which is called in the Hebrew the mouth, and takes them to the place called the mouth, where they are set and trapped. It seems like there's no way out. I want to encourage somebody today that feels like you're in a place that there's no way out. I want to speak to someone who feels like you can't keep going ahead. You can't go to the left. You can't go to the right. It'll just hurt your heart if you ever have to go back. I want to speak to someone who feels like they're in a trap and don't know what to do. The bills are behind and they can't pay it, but they're scared to go to work. I want to speak to someone whose relationships is all messed up and you're in a situation that you know you shouldn't be. I want to speak to someone who's sick in their body and they really can't do nothing to make it better, but wait and see what God's doing. I want to speak to someone who's at the end of the rope and about ready to throw in the towel, and you feel like, what's the use of fighting? What's the use of holding on? I want to speak to someone who can't find nobody to encourage them, can't find nobody to lift them up. I want to let you know that God's not done yet. Now God's not done yet. God's not done yet. Now God's not done, and the battle's not over. When you look at this situation here, God has taken Israel to his stage. He departed from the journey to take them to the stage. God was about to show himself again one more time. Could it be that God has delayed your victory just so he can set your stage? Could it be God has delayed your deliverance just so he can set your stage? Could it be that God has delayed your breakthrough just so he can set your stage? Could it be God has delayed your healing just so he can set your stage? And when you look at this here, Israel has been led to the place called the Mount, and the stage has been set. They could have got away a long time ago, but God led them on a path that caused them to have to wait for their deliverance. They could have got free a long time ago, but God led them on a path that made them have to endure just a little while longer. I thought Egypt was off their back, but God allowed Egypt to get on their back one more time. I know it's not a popular thing, and if you're like me, nobody wants to have to wait on their breakthrough or deliverance. But sometimes you don't have a choice but to wait on the Lord. I want to encourage somebody today that's in the midst of their valley and they have nothing left to do but to wait on the Lord. When you look at Daniel, the third chapter, Daniel had to learn how to wait on the Lord. Daniel didn't get delivered. And then Daniel, the three Hebrew boys, didn't get delivered when they start telling folk that they serve the Most High God. They still had to wait for their deliverance. Daniel didn't get delivered when they got tied up and bound up. They still had to wait on their deliverance. God could have snuffed out the fire, but God didn't stop them from getting thrown in the fire. They had to wait on their deliverance. God threw them in the fire and didn't allow the fire to go out. They still had to wait on their deliverance. The chains and the bonds caught on fire all around them. And they was looking at fire all around them and the chains on fire. But they still had to wait on their deliverance. But it was just a little while later that God brought them out. And he joined them in the midst of the fire. And they got the deliverance by that. And God showed them that he is a strong God. And God was able to deliver. Daniel had to wait on his deliverance. Daniel was doing nothing but praying unto the Lord. Daniel didn't hurt nobody, talk about nobody. Daniel didn't try to do nobody wrong. Daniel spent time praying unto the Lord. But when you look at Daniel chapter 6, verse 16, Daniel gets in trouble for praying unto the Lord. But when you look at 6:16, it says the king commanded, and they brought Daniel and cast him into the lion's den. God didn't deliver Daniel before he got thrown in the lion's den. Under 6:17, a stone was brought and placed over the den of the lion. God didn't deliver Daniel when the stone got brought over the lion's den. Then all night long, Daniel had to lay in the midst of the lion's den. It says right here that 6:18, that the king went back to his palace, went back, tried to sleep, but couldn't, fasted all night long. But guess what? All night long, Daniel had to sit in the middle of the lion's den. God didn't get him out till early the next morning. He had to wait in the den all night long. Sometimes you gotta wait in the den, but I come to let you know God will get him out miraculously. Paul was put on a boat heading to Rome. God didn't get him out yet miraculously. The Bible says in verse 14, there arose a tempestuous wind. God didn't stop the wind from blowing. Daniel had to endure the wind. You look at verse 19. Amen. They had to get rid of the tackle boxes and all the weights. God didn't stop them from losing everything on the ship. You look at verse 41. The waves started breaking the ship apart. God didn't stop the ship from breaking apart. You look at verse 44. The boat was broken into pieces. God didn't stop the boat from breaking into pieces. God didn't stop them from being tossed into the water. But God says, I'm still going to save your life. All you got to do right now, Paul, is hold on to a piece of board, and I will get you saved. Paul had to learn how to wait on the Lord. It didn't happen quickly, but it happened on time. Somebody listening today, wait on God to come through. When it is your blessing going to take place, when it is your deliverance going to happen, when your breakthrough going to happen, when your money going to get right, when your body going to get healed, when your husband going to act right, when your wife going to act right, when you going to get the job that you need. I come to tell somebody, don't give up. Weak and may endure for a night. The joy comes in the morning. I don't know how long you got to wait, but I don't mind waiting. But God's going to bring the news. You want to give God some praise and tell the Lord, thank you, that he didn't forget about me. Chariots can't ride on the landscape because the sand is not conducive to those chariots riding. But right before they get to the place where the chariots can't go, God makes them make a detour. Egypt turns from the place that was promised because God didn't just want to bring them out, but he was waiting on the 600 chariots. God didn't just want to bring them out. He was waiting on the 600 horses to catch them. Before God got them out, God waited for their enemy to catch up to them because he couldn't get rid of the enemy and yet get the glory until the enemy got to the stage too. Could it be that the reason you are still waiting is God is waiting on your enemy to get to the stage also? Could it be that the reason you still wait is because you know God's still going to bring it through? One of the shows that I love to watch, I got it recorded on my DVR. I watch it every day almost. I love watching Hogan's Heroes because I know by the end of the show, they're going to get the victory. They get in some what they call sticky wickies. And they get in these sticky wicky situations. And when they get in these situations, they wonder how they're going to get out. But somehow before the show is over, they've accomplished their mission. And the enemy has been defeated. But the enemy sometimes gets too close for comfort. But they know by the end of the story, I know that every episode they're going to get the victory. Because that's how the story is written. I come to let somebody know that every episode you're going to get the victory. Because I know how the story is written. I already know the author of your life. I know the creator of your souls. Even though you're going through, I'm telling you, you're going to come out, even though
this, God will bring you through. Don't allow your weight to make you give up the faith. And don't allow your weight to make you think God does not care. God cares. God has not forgotten you. Say that to yourself. God has not forgotten me. Lay your hand on yourself and say, He has not forgotten me. I'm still the apple of His eye. He went to the cross just for me. He did it. If it was nobody else but Joe Walker, he would have died just for me. He has not forgotten about us. Sometimes you gotta wait. We're in a difficult season. We've been 9 months in. And I know some of you are tired of being locked up. Some of you are tired of missing church. Tired of wearing a mask. Tired of being distanced. Tired of not hugging. Hey, you couldn't get with your family for Thanksgiving. You want to get with your family for Christmas. You want to go shopping. You want to do this. Sometimes you got to wait. Listen. I know we're hearing all these people with different ideas of what's going on. But let me tell you some consistent facts. God always gets glory. Like last week, even if he has to come down and do it himself. So when you look at what's happening right now, I just want you to know God is setting the stage that he can get the glory. He's setting the stage. Be encouraged today. Know that God loves you. And we're praying for you as you pray for us. And don't give up, because God's not done yet. Father, we thank you for each and every one who's tuned in today, those who are listening and those who have even want to listen later tonight. And we pray, God, that they will not give up the faith. They will not turn back. God, sometimes we don't understand the path, but let us know that we can trust the guide. And that is your Spirit. Encourage those who are discouraged. Strengthen those that are weak. Give hope to those who feel no hope. Let them know, God, that you have not forgotten about them and that you will do just what you said you would. We thank you for those right now, Father, who are listening, who may not know you in the free pardon of their sins. If you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, we want to make that invitation to you. That you can do it now. Now is the time of salvation. Don't play with tomorrow when we don't know what tomorrow brings. If you have not made sure that if you were to die, you have a place with him in heaven, you don't know for sure where you would be, but we invite you at this time to make Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior. All you have to do is ask him to come into your heart, repent of your sins, and he will come in. Ask him to come in. Confess that you believe in his death, his burial, and his resurrection. Surrender yourselves and he'll come into your life. And if that's a decision you've made, amen, we want to talk with you. Give us a call at 330-469-5428. That's 330-469-5428. Amen. We praise God for today, for all he's done. Amen. If you, wherever you are right now, would you give God a praise for the ministry of giving? Amen. Amen. We thank God for the opportunity to give. We encourage you, as God has been good to you, if you've been watching this ministry and God has been blessing you through it, we invite you to sow into the house. God is doing a good work. If you're part of the house, we encourage you to tithe. We believe in tithing and offering in our home. Amen. We believe there's a blessing in tithing. There's a blessing that you cannot beat when you tithe. So we believe that if you do that, God will do some things. It's not what pastors want to do, not what restoration is going to do. But the Lord says he will open up windows, pour out blessings. He will cause men to give unto you. He didn't say just go give you something. He said press down, shake it together, running over shall men give unto you. Amen. If you, amen, are part of this house, we encourage you to go ahead and tithe to this place. Amen. We need you to keep being faithful in your giving. Keep sowing into the kingdom here. And if you have been blessed, we invite you to sow into this ground. It's good ground, I promise you that. You can give through Cash App at $RCF760 or through our Giblify app. Both of those are on the bottom of the screen. The Giblify app is also on our webpage at iamrestored.biz. iamrestored.biz. But if you'd like to mail it in, we still check the mail. We check the mail. 760 Main Street, Southwest, Warren, Ohio, 44483. Amen. 760 Main, that's where we're located. We thank you for your giving. I want to pray for you in your giving. That God will bless you. Father, we thank you for those who have sown and who are sowing into this house. We thank you, God, for their faithfulness. Even though they can't physically get to the house, God, we're grateful that you've made a way for the word to go forth and still reach them and reach their ears. And we pray for them, God, as they give, that you will bless this offering, bless the gifts, bless the givers. God, that as we give by faith, that we will see your word come true in our lives. Help us, God, to stand by faith on your word. God, we pray there will be no lack in the house of the people of God. Bless God for food, bless for bills to be paid. Bless God for houses to be paid, loans to be paid, insurances to be taken care of. Comfort them, keep them, and bless them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God, we thank you for joining us. Restoration, listen, whether you got an email from us or check our members-only webpage, we're going to be having a church fellowship this Tuesday at 7 o'clock. We will not be having a Bible study on our open page, but for the Restoration members, I need to hear your voice. Amen. I want to see you like you see me. So we're going to be going to Zoom fellowship. So please join us Tuesday night, 7 o'clock, and next Tuesday at 7 o'clock. I look forward to it. I'm really excited about seeing your faces and hearing your voices again. Until Tuesday night, you be blessed. May the peace of God come to you and keep you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.